jury find that defendant Ryan William Ferguson guilty of murder in the second degree as submitted in instruction number 11.
October of 2005, when Ryan was found guilty, it just sucked the air right out of us. We were absolutely devastated. My name is Bill Ferguson, and my son is Ryan Ferguson. It is a surreal, sickening feeling to realize that my son is in the maximum security prison for a crime that he did not commit.
Tell us what your reaction to the verdict is.
I'm satisfied.
Are you absolutely convinced that Chuck Erickson and Ryan Ferguson killed Kent Heitel?
I wouldn't have prosecuted this case if I wasn't. Halloween night, there's going to be a lot of people out running around drunk and stuff.
Ken Heitel was leaving work, and he was found dead in the parking lot.
911, what is your emergency?
We need someone here at the Columbia Daily Tribune.
What's going on?
It's hard to imagine taking a metal object, smash it down on their skull until they drop to the ground.
The sports editor, Kent, laying on the ground, pool of blood.
He was a kind person. He liked the people he worked with, and he loved his family, loved his kids. It's definitely the strangest case that I've ever dealt with, and I think I've had some pretty weird cases.
There's nothing linking Ryan to this crime. There's no evidence. The only thing linking him to this crime is Chuck.
Chuck told his friends that he thought that he may have been at the crime scene and may have had something to do with the crime.
He had told a few of his friends he had been having these dreams of being involved in this murder.
This all came from a confused kid's dream.
I hoped that it was a dream. I did hope that it was a dream. The memories, they seem kind of dreamlike. I did this. He did this. I didn't dream anything.
There's no way. Absolutely no way. Ryan is just very sweet. He's always been like that. He's my brother. I love him.
I'm going to be able to prove that my son is innocent. I didn't know how, but I knew I could.
I am Ryan Ferguson, and I am an innocent man.
The Lost Night, tonight's 48 Hours Mystery. Mystery continues in 90 seconds.
I started going to the crime scene within a week of the arrest. I'd go down at 1:30, I'd stay down until 3 o'clock, and I would sit in different parts of the whole crime scene from all different angles. And I do it every Halloween for sure.
Bill Ferguson is a driven man.
How many times have you gone down to the crime scene?
40 or 50 at least.
A real estate broker, nothing in his life ever prepared him for what he is doing now. Trying to solve a 10-year-old murder.
What did you know about investigations before this?
Well, I used to watch Perry Mason.
One thing Ferguson knows for sure, he says, is that his 26-year-old son, Ryan, is innocent.
I want to be exonerated. I want everyone to know that I have absolutely nothing to do with this case.
Ryan is Bill's only son.
We've always been close, been really, really close. He never gave us any trouble at all.
Ryan had just turned 21 in 2005 when he was convicted and sentenced to 40 years. The key witness against him, his high school friend Chuck Erickson, who told the court that he and Ryan robbed and murdered 48-year-old Kent Heitholt.
Was there any side of you wondering, well, God, Chuck is willing to go to prison for this? Maybe Chuck and Ryan did this?
No. I know that my son could not have committed this crime because the facts prove that that is not possible.
It was that Halloween night in 2001 when Kent, the popular sports editor of Columbia, Missouri's newspaper, The Tribune, worked into the wee hours.
Ken Heitholt was a big, bubbly, friendly bear of a man.
Sports reporter Russ Baer was among the handful of people there with him.
A good guy, very relaxed, very laid back.
Part-time writer Mike Boyd was also there. He says he was getting ready to drive off the parking lot a little after 2 a.m. when Kent came out. Boyd stopped to speak with him.
Did he seem concerned about anything at that moment?
No, just like normal. It was just a normal night.
What was the last thing Kent said to you?
I can't remember the exact words of what he said, but it was just more lines of see you later. And I thought it would.
Minutes after Boyd left, two janitors on the loading dock saw that Kent's car was still there, the driver's door open.
I had that gut feeling that something was wrong.
Shauna Orndt remembers seeing two shadowy figures emerge from behind the car. One ran away. The other, a college-aged male, she says, stopped to speak.
Looked me dead in the eyes and said, somebody's hurt. And he walked off casually, like nothing had happened.
Alerted to the incident, Russ Baer rushed outside and found Kent's body by his car.
I was like, what the hell's going on here? I couldn't believe what I saw.
Kent Heitholt had been bludgeoned and strangled.
Not the kind of guy you'd think would be murdered?
No, definitely. I mean, just size alone, a big 6'5", 300-pound guy, that is not the kind of guy I'd want to mess with in a dark parking lot.
No one's going to mess with Kent. Who's going to mess with Kent?
Earlier on that same Halloween night, Ryan Ferguson and Chuck Erickson, 17-year-old high school students at the time, managed to sneak into a bar a few blocks away.
Underage drinking?
Yeah. I had a few drinks. I was not intoxicated. You know, it's something that goes on in college towns.
Around 1:15, about an hour before the murder, Ryan says everyone was kicked out, including himself and Chuck.
I dropped him off at his house and I went home myself. It's a very simple, easy night.
Did you have anything to do with the murder of Kent Heitholt?
I have absolutely nothing to do with the murder of Kent Heitholt. I wasn't even anywhere near that crime scene.
Whoever was at the crime scene may have left clues. Police found fingerprints on Kent's car, hairs in his hand, and bloody shoe prints on the ground.
People in Columbia are desperate to solve this case.
And they had the two janitors. One could not provide a detailed description of the men they saw. But the other one, Shauna, said she got a good look at the man who spoke.
He was tall, he was skinny, he had light-colored hair.
The police released a sketch and fielded dozens of leads, but none of them went anywhere. Kent Heitholt's murder was a mystery.
It just doesn't seem possible that anybody could hurt him. And being as nice as he was, why?
2 years passed before there was finally a break. In November 2003, the Tribune published an anniversary story about the unsolved crime, and that prompted Chuck Erickson to have disturbing thoughts, vague ideas, dreams, that he was somehow involved in the murder. He told some friends.
He said, I had a dream.
I had a dream?
Yeah. About the crime, bits and pieces of it.
The police got wind of what Chuck was saying and brought him in. In a bizarre taped interview, Chuck seems cooperative, but also clueless.
It's just so foggy, like I could just be sitting here fabricating all this.
He doesn't even seem to know the weapon used to strangle Kent Heitholt.
I think it was a shirt or something.
Well, I know it wasn't a shirt.
It was like maybe a bungee cord.
We know for a fact that his belt was ripped off of his pants and he was strangled with his belt.
Really?
Does that ring a bell?
Not at all.
And that's the way most of the interview goes. What Chuck doesn't know about the crime, the police tell him.
You see where this Jeep is at right up here?
They even show him where the crime occurred.
That is the parking spot where Mr. Heitholt had his car parked.
Still, Chuck's memory seems vague at best.
I don't recall what happened, so I don't know.
And that frustrates the cops.
It's you that is on this chopping block. And I don't want to hear, all of a sudden I just think I maybe fabricated all this.
Chuck Erickson fits their profile, at least half of it. Two young men were seen that night. So police press Chuck to give up the friend he was with on Halloween. And he does.
Whose idea was it?
It was Ryan's idea.
Ryan's idea.
Ryan Ferguson.
I wasn't there. I didn't do anything.
Ryan, then in college, is also brought in. Police question him for hours, but he never wavers.
Trying to get me to admit to something I didn't do. I'm not lying to you, man. I was not there.
Still, in March 2004, 2 years after the crime, Ryan Ferguson and Chuck Erickson are arrested and charged with murder.
This tears at your heart. It's just a moment of desperation.
Ryan's father, his older sister Kelly, and mother Leslie are prepared to fight for him.
They just don't have this story right.
Is the state ready to proceed?
There's something that is going to come out that's going to free him.
But things are about to get much worse.
We killed that man for nothing.
I think our hearts are beating pretty fast right now.
All right, please.
You're there for a horrible thing.
The defendant strangled the victim to death.
And they're looking at me like I'm some kind of criminal.
Ryan Ferguson, once a college student, is now a defendant on trial for the murder of Kent Heitholt.
The defendant denied any involvement with the murder.
Instead of a dorm, his home for the past year and a half has been jail.
I was emotionally spent. My soul had been crushed.
The state calls Charles Erickson.
The state star witness, Chuck Erickson, is also a changed man. The once befuddled teen is now a polished witness for the prosecution.
Could you raise your right hand, please?
And he's made a deal. He will plead guilty to second-degree murder in exchange for his testimony.
I did this. He did this. I didn't dream anything.
While Chuck will spend less than 25 years in prison, Ryan faces life.
I could care less about what happens to him. I'm just doing this because I know it's the right thing to do.
A composed Chuck now says that when he and Ryan left a bar on that Halloween night in 2001, Ryan suggested they rob someone to get more drinking money. They chose their victim at random, he says, and things got out of hand.
What did the defendant in this case, Ryan Ferguson, did to him?
He robbed him and he strangled him.
Chuck seems to vividly recall every detail and demonstrates how Ryan held a man twice his size on the ground.
He was down here and he had a belt and he had his foot on his back, on the victim's back, and he was pulling up on the belt like this.
After the murder, past 2:30 in the morning, Chuck tells the jury, they went back to the bar, getting past the same bouncer who let them in earlier.
What'd you and him talk about inside the bar?
I didn't say anything. I was just upset about what we'd done.
But there is no physical evidence to back Chuck's story.
Do you have either Ryan Ferguson's or Chuck Erickson's fingerprints at the scene?
No.
Do you have a murder weapon in this case?
Did we find the murder weapon? No.
In fact, none of the fingerprints, shoe prints, or hairs found matched Ryan or Chuck, and Kent's wallet was found in his car. But prosecutor Kevin Crane has faith in his star witness.
It is definitely possible to consciously put something out of your mind that you don't want to remember because it's a terrible, terrible thing.
You may call your next witness.
And Crane has his trump card.
Jury, Trump.
He's the janitor who saw the two men that night but couldn't give police a detailed description. But now in court...
If you see the individual, would you point to that individual, please?
Yes.
When he pointed to you in the courtroom, how did you feel?
I was disgusted because I know this man did not see me.
Trump explains it this way. While in jail on a sex charge, his memory was jogged by the arrest photos in the newspaper.
I recognize the two pictures. I've seen these two faces before at the Tribune that night that Kent was killed.
Come forward and be sworn, please.
Ryan's older sister testifies for the defense.
Kelly Ferguson?
But on cross-examination, she's forced to admit it was her idea to get Ryan and Chuck past the bouncer at the bar.
That was because your brother and Mr. Erickson were both well underage, isn't that correct?
Correct.
Thinking back on it wasn't the wisest decision. I definitely do carry a lot of guilt.
You swear the testimony you may give in this matter to be the truth?
When Ryan takes the stand, he denies Chuck's accusations.
Did you go to the Tribune parking lot?
No.
Did you see Kent Heitholt anywhere?
No.
Did you participate in this murder?
No.
His lawyers are confident the jurors will believe Ryan more than Chuck, that the interrogation tapes undermine Chuck's credibility, especially since there's no forensic evidence to corroborate his story.
I've got to tell him what that man did.
But the jury believes the now self-assured Chuck they heard testify.
We couldn't see no reason why he would have gave himself up for 25 years of his life.
He looked over at Mr. Ferguson and the pleading look in his eye, like, come on, buddy, you know you did it. You might as well fess up.
It takes them just 5 hours to reach a verdict.
We, the jury, find that defendant Ryan William Ferguson guilty of murder in the second degree.
Guilty.
We feel very, very badly for the Heitholt family.
Before sentencing, Ryan's father is allowed to address the jury.
If he gets the jail sentence that I'm hearing, I will never live long enough to see him outside of jail.
Ryan is sentenced to 40 years.
Oh, it's really scary. It's really scary. We were in shock.
From that moment on, Bill was on a mission to prove that Chuck's story was impossible.
I gotta get busy. I got a lot of work to do.
6 months later, he's tracked down his first new witness.
I had to go through the university records. I went over to the fraternity house. I asked a lot of questions.
The bouncer, who Chuck said, let Ryan and him back into the bar after the murder.
He said that at 1:30 they would lock the doors.
And that's every single night?
Yes, every single night without fail. So there's no way that Erickson could have come up onto the nightclub at 2:45.
And on one of Bill's many visits to the crime scene late at night, he had noticed a traffic light. Instead of changing from green to red, it's flashing yellow.
So the next day, I called the Missouri Department of Transportation, asked them when those lights changed. They said every night and at 1:00.
It's another fact that contradicts Chuck's story. Chuck told police that as he and Ryan were fleeing the crime scene around 2:30 a.m., they saw a classmate stopped at the light there.
It's difficult to get people to stop at red lights, let alone a flashing yellow light.
What's more, that classmate denies he was there.
I didn't have a license to drive. I had no automobile in my name.
Bill Ferguson also gets surprising information from Shauna Orndt, the janitor who did describe one of the men by Kent's car.
Did he have any blood on him?
Not that I noticed, no.
Shauna insists that before the trial, she told the prosecutor that the man she saw was not Ryan or Chuck.
Neither one of them, I seen neither one of those kids. He's like, well, I know that those are the kids that did it. I know for a fact they did it, and you're wrong.
Bill Ferguson is convinced he has enough evidence to prove that Chuck Erickson made up his story.
Did you ever have any idea your dad was going to turn out to be such a devoted investigator?
I had no idea his capabilities. It's phenomenal.
But will it be enough to get Ryan's case back in court?
All we want to do is just get in front of a judge and a jury, and it would be obvious.
If I'm even sure about this.
Let me just stop you there for a moment.
The more Bill Ferguson studied Chuck Erickson's police interrogations, the more he believed that not only is his son Ryan innocent, so is Ryan's accuser.
He looks someone that's totally lost. He doesn't know anything about the crime scene. I think it's the first time he's ever been there, quite honestly.
What Chuck knew about Kent Heitholt's murder, says Bill, seemed to come from the police.
Well, we know for a fact that his belt was ripped off and was passing restraining with his belt.
Really? Yeah.
They fed him all the information.
But why would Chuck want to fit the evidence?
That's the $64,000 question. Who knows? I have no idea how his mind works.
It's a huge missing piece of the puzzle. Why Chuck was willing to go to prison for a crime he seemed to know nothing about.
I think they put a lot of pressure on him to comply with the evidence. I think what happens is, in Chuck's heart, he did it. He knows no details because he wasn't there.
And Chuck's story continues to fall apart. This woman, Christine Varner, comes forward on her own.
It's your conscience. I felt I had to do it.
Varner once managed the agency that employed Jerry Trump, the janitor who definitively ID'd Ryan at trial. When she saw Trump's testimony on 48 Hours when we first aired this story,
I'm thinking, how can you do that? That's not what you had said.
Varner says that shortly after the murder in 2001, Trump told her that he'd never be able to identify the men he saw by Kent's car.
But he said that the way the lighting was, I couldn't tell who was there at all.
3 years of digging for new witnesses finally pays off for Bill. In July 2008, the state agrees to hear the new evidence.
I'm referring to when he pointed to Ryan and said, I saw him.
Christine Varner is one of 22 witnesses who testify.
You may be seated right there, please.
Many who undermine the state's case against Ryan.
Now we're able to, for the first time, present this new evidence, so we were very excited.
The state, however, questions the credibility of some of the witnesses.
Shauna Elizabeth Arndt.
For example, the janitor who now claims she told the prosecutor she didn't see either Ryan or Chuck the night of the murder, had actually earlier said in a sworn statement that she wasn't sure. She tells 48 Hours that back then, she felt pressured by the prosecutor.
Kevin Crane had me so intimidated, and so, I don't know, I was scared of what he would do or say to me if I said, you know, something.
But prosecutor Kevin Crane says Shauna did tell him she just wasn't sure. After the hearing, the judge takes nearly a year to make a decision. And it's a huge disappointment for Ryan. No new trial. His conviction will stand.
It broke me in a way because I allowed myself to get hopeful.
But Ryan's father does not accept defeat. And out of the blue, he's found a new ally.
I like target shooting. I find it relaxing.
Kathleen Zellner doesn't even live in Missouri. She's a high-profile attorney in Chicago who also saw the 48 Hours report.
A case like this to me is just consuming.
She agrees to take Ryan's case pro bono, but she's worried.
My big concern is that I came into the case so late. I'm not sure that the case is salvageable.
Hey, McAvely, you're saying that you truly believe Ryan Ferguson had nothing to do with this murder, that he's completely innocent?
I know.
But you're not absolutely sure you can get him out?
Right, because the case has just progressed procedurally so far.
Zellner believes the entire case was based on a faulty premise.
The police came up with a theory and just, you know, bought into it 100% that these two people that came upon the scene were the murderers.
These two white guys. But Zellner thinks that the two young men seen there were not the killers at all, just college kids cutting across the lot. That's why one of them stopped to tell the janitors to get help.
Who would do that if you just commit a murder? You want to get the police there faster? I don't think so.
Because of that wrong assumption, Zellner says, other possible suspects were not fully investigated. In particular, the last person known to see Kent Heitholt alive, sports writer Mike Boyd.
Did the police take hair samples, fingerprints, check Boyd's car?
No, none of the above.
Boyd was never interrogated, although he has cooperated with investigators from both sides. He did expect to come under more scrutiny in the beginning.
Were you worried at all the police would look at you? I mean, because you
were... Oh, immediately, yeah, because I was the last one, you know, and I've
to
seen
see
my,
him.
I've seen my share of crime shows to realize that they always, you know, look at the time of all this and where were you and what were you doing. And
he admits that over the years he has given troubling, inconsistent statements, telling one investigator he was driving a blue car that night, later telling another he was in a red car.
What car were you driving that night?
That's how tired I was.
That night, on Halloween night, what car do you think you were driving?
I'm going to say the red car.
After Ryan and Chuck were arrested, Boyd claimed that he also saw two young men by the parking lot. But that doesn't match what he told police on the night of the murder.
Boyd stated he did not see anybody around the parking lot or anybody who was suspicious in nature.
Okay.
Is that what you told John Short right after the murder?
I do remember having to go back and tell him that I did see two people. Yes, I did.
There's no police report filed that says that you saw two people.
Later on. That night, I remember there were so many questions, so many things going through my head that it's just, and I'm still tired.
And let me ask you a very tough question.
Sure.
Did you fight with Kent that night? Did you have anything to do with
no.
his murder?
No, ma'am. No, ma'am.
Zellner believes that Ryan's jury should have been told about Michael Boyd.
I can't possibly know if Michael Boyd committed this murder, and I wouldn't say that, but I do think that he raises reasonable doubt about Ryan Ferguson's guilt.
Zellner is confident she could win if Ryan gets a new trial and is determined to get an appeals court to hear his case. But that won't be easy.
Once you're convicted, the system works completely against you. The analogy I think of is that he's in quicksand and I'm trying to grab a hold of him.
She needs more evidence and she's about to get it from the last person she'd ever expect to hear from. In November 2009, Ryan Ferguson got a letter and a big shock.
I didn't know if I should open it.
It was from someone he had not heard from since his trial 4 years earlier.
I was scared of it, you know, and at the same time, it was, you know, my adrenaline was going because I'm perplexed.
The letter was from his accuser, Chuck Erickson.
He says, Ryan, have your lawyers come speak to me the next time that they're down here.
Attorney Kathleen Zellner, who had been working Ryan's case for only a few weeks, arranged a visit with Erickson in prison.
He knew it was something extremely important. That's why he didn't waste any time getting there.
She doesn't know what he wants to say, but whatever it is, she wants it on the record.
May I call you Chuck?
Mr. Erickson, Charles.
Mr. Erickson.
I don't know about Chuck.
Erickson reads a statement he's prepared.
Things happened much differently than I had previously stated.
I could not accept in my conscious mind that I was the sole perpetrator and aggressor.
The sole perpetrator. Erickson now says he's the one who killed Kent Heitholt.
I beat the victim, Kent Heitholt, until he was on the ground. Then I took his belt off and strangled him with it.
Ryan, he says, was only a witness.
I did not tell Ryan what I was going to do. He had no idea that I would act in such an aggressive manner.
Ryan even tried to stop him, Erickson says. He says he lied about Ryan's involvement to save himself.
Well, it was too hard to throw away my entire life and put my head on, quote, the chopping block. I regret now that I put an innocent man through that. He didn't deserve it.
Is it correct that you're the one who declined to have an attorney present today?
That's correct.
I kept saying to him, are you sure you want to say this? And then he would say, yes, I'm positive. I need to fix this.
My reaction was, thank God this man has finally admitted that I have nothing to do with this crime.
But it's not that simple.
Isn't there a problem? He's exonerated you by saying you had nothing to do with the murder, but he has said you were there.
I believe he thinks that he committed the crime. My personal belief is that he didn't.
You don't even think he was there either.
I don't think he was there. I know I wasn't there.
Witnesses often recant, but in this case, Zellner hopes Erickson's statement will get Ryan a new trial. She says Erickson put himself at great risk. If he had remained quiet, he could have been released in less than 4 years from now. But by changing his story and admitting he lied at trial, he might have to serve his full 25-year sentence.
This is a very daring thing that he's done. I mean, he's thrown himself on his sword for Ryan, and I don't know what the outcome of it will be.
For Chuck to come forth and say that he committed perjury tells us that we're on our way to the truth and to reality.
Are you afraid to get your hopes up this time?
Cautiously, but yeah, we're never going to believe it until we have arms around him.
1 month after Ryan got his letter, there's more from Erickson. Another letter, this time to Zellner, in which Erickson tries to explain his condition on the night of the crime.
He wanted to make sure that we knew that he was out of his mind on drugs and alcohol. I was under a lot of stress and filled with a lot of pain.
I mean, do you believe this story?
I don't think it matters whether I believe it or not. All I know is that he's saying he committed perjury.
That Erickson committed perjury is the argument Kathleen Zellner takes to an appellate court in August 2010, 9 months after getting Erickson's statement.
It's imperative that the court realizes this is a true emergency.
She wants the court to bend its own rules to save Ryan Ferguson, whom she believes should never have been sent to prison in the first place.
Good morning, folks. Please have a seat. Ferguson versus State of Missouri.
Zellner pleads her case to the three judges.
There is compelling evidence that my client is innocent, and every day that he sits in a maximum security prison, his life is in danger.
But she knows what she's up against.
Courts don't want to retry cases. It adds to workload. They don't want to reverse cases.
3.5 weeks later, there's a decision. Ryan's conviction is again upheld. But this time, there's a glimmer of hope. The judges admit that the case does give them pause because the sole evidence tying Ferguson to the crime was the testimony of Erickson and the identification from Trump, the janitor.
They said, you've got what looks like really persuasive evidence, but you need to go to another court.
How did Ryan take it? It had to be disappointing.
Oh, it was. I mean, sometimes I talk to him and I think he sounds like an old soul.
Zellner has to file a different kind of appeal in yet another court.
This case is really at the end of the road.
What do you mean at the end of the road?
There isn't anywhere else to go with it if this doesn't work.
Ryan's burden is high. He must prove his innocence. And he may just be able to do it, as the last piece of evidence against him seems to fall apart.
Do you ever think about the Heitholt family?
I do. I do. And I think about what they must be going through.
Ryan Ferguson is not the only one whose life was shattered when someone took the life of Kent Heitholt.
I know personally myself and my family, it's been the most horrifying experience. It's painful, but we're also here for each other. To go through what they've been through, it's almost incomprehensible, you know?
The Heitholt family deserved justice. They deserve to know who actually committed that crime.
There has never been any physical evidence tying Ryan Ferguson to Kent Heitholt's murder. And one of the two crucial witnesses against him has changed his story. Now, as attorney Kathleen Zellner prepares Ryan's third appeal in less than 3 years, the other witness has come forward as well.
He now says he lied.
Yes.
Remember the janitor who identified Ryan Ferguson as the young man he saw at the crime scene? In court, Trump said he was in jail, saw a picture of Ryan in the newspaper, and had a sudden recall. Now, he is drastically changing his story.
What does he now say?
He now says it was the prosecutor who came up with the idea of having him look at a newspaper article, and then all of a sudden he recognized Erickson and Ferguson.
Prosecutor Kevin Crane said he didn't show photos to Trump until the day he testified. But whatever happened, Trump says in a sworn affidavit that he would now testify that he cannot positively identify the two people I saw.
Why would he admit this now?
I have no idea. Maybe he has a conscience.
The tougher question is why Erickson has changed his story. Kathleen Zellner believes she's found the answer to that, too.
What does Erickson now believe happened that night?
He says he has no memory of any of it. He doesn't remember any of it.
Erickson had been abusing drugs since he was 14. At the time of the murder, she says, he was in particularly bad shape.
He was essentially in a blackout state. He did a line of cocaine, he snorted Adderall, and he consumed at least, that he remembers, 8 alcoholic drinks.
Just weeks later, his worried parents put him through exhaustive psychological testing at the University of Missouri. The result? This assessment, which revealed there were huge holes in his memory.
The whole case was built on Charles Erickson's memory.
That's correct.
And I think that is powerful evidence that his memory was severely impaired.
Couldn't the state, though, use that same assessment to say, well, that explains why he didn't remember this terrible event for 2 years and then it came flooding back?
No. You ask anyone who's ever had an alcoholic blackout and they will tell you it's just a blank in their memory. You don't retrieve it. It doesn't come back. It's like the recorder's not turned on.
2 years later, Erickson was under enormous pressure to confess.
Ryan's going to talk. Don't let Ryan tell a story for you.
Zellner says he was made to believe that Ryan Ferguson had also confessed and was ready to testify against him.
He was told that Ryan was negotiating a deal, that Ryan was going to admit to the murder.
And that wasn't true.
It was flatly untrue.
Zellner says that's why Erickson was willing to adopt the details given him by police as his own.
Would you take the witness stand, please?
By trial, he had become that polished witness, even willing to go to prison himself.
I think he had this blank in his memory, and I think he believed right up to the end that Ryan was going to turn on him, and he thought, God, we must have done it, because why would Ryan be saying this?
Now, she says, Erickson is finally beginning to question it all, and he too has a new attorney to help him with his case.
When you're finished fighting for Ryan Ferguson, you're going to fight for Chuck Erickson.
I will, yeah, because one case cannot survive without the other. And when one goes down, the other one's going to go down.
The man who urged her to take on Erickson's case? Ryan's father, Bill Ferguson.
In my mind, Charles Erickson is innocent.
But Bill's first priority is his son.
What my family wants to see right now is for Ryan to be exonerated as soon as possible.
7 years after Ryan's arrest, Bill hand-delivers the legal document that asks for a new hearing, which he believes will finally lead to his son's freedom.
My name is Bill Ferguson. We just filed a habeas case.
Oh, okay.
And so this is your copy.
The petition lays out all the new evidence that Zellner and her team have uncovered, most notably those sworn statements from the only two witnesses who connect Ryan to the crime, Chuck Erickson and Jerry Trump, who say they lied at the trial.
We knew that sooner or later the truth would come out.
This time, Bill says, he finally feels that his mission is nearing an end.
The day that Ryan walks out of prison, I'm going to feel, as a father, that I have done my job.
I mean, he's a colonel in the Air Force.
Someone was stealing women's lingerie.
He had flown the Queen.
He was going to kill me with one slice.
And then from there, we go to murder.
You ever been interviewed by the police in a room like this before?
I have never been interviewed like this.
I've seen war criminals, hitmen. I've never seen anything like this before.
On television, online, on the go, and now free on iPad. CBS News.